अस्सलाम वालेकुम, वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू इन दिस सेकंड लेक्चर ऑफ म्युनिसिपल फ्लडिंग। इन फर्स्ट लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द एफसीएम प्रोसेस, द फर्स्ट कॉन्टेक्ट म्युनिसिपल प्रोसेस, एंड वी हैव आल्सो कवर्ड एन एक्सरसाइज रिलेटेड टू द डिज़ाइनिंग ऑफ एन एफसीएम प्रोसेस। इन एक्सरसाइज इफ यू रिमेंबर, बेसिकली वी हैव अज्यूम अ सिंपल असम्पशन that reservoir oil is composed of a single component which was normal decaying in the exercise, and also we have assumed that in the injected fluid was either propane or methane. Both propane and methane are also a single component, which is propane pure component. So when you are dealing with pure component, you can obviously take use of the phase behavior diagram of pure components, but we know that reservoir oils are never pure component. All of the reservoir oil are the mixture of different components. For example, volatile oil reservoir, black oil, or a heavy oil reservoir. These all oil reservoirs have multi components in their composition. Obviously, volatile oil has a lower quantity of C7 plus as compared to black oil and heavy oil, but still all the oil have multi components. So when you have multi components in reservoir oil and maybe in injected gas, so you cannot use the phase behavior diagram of a pure component. So in that case, we use the Tunney diagrams. Tunney diagram obviously is our next topic. Tunney diagrams basically are the phase behavior diagrams of a multi-component mixture. For example, if you want to form a mixture of, for example, seven components, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, at a particular pressure and temperature, you want to check whether these seven components, when mixed together in a mixture at a particular pressure and temperature, what phase they will have. So the phase behavior of a multi-component mixture is studied through Tunney diagram. So obviously, this is our topic, and through Tunney diagrams, you will see that we will determine whether it's proposed injection will be FCM or it will be MCM or immiscible. For example, if you want to inject methane in reservoir, which in reservoir oil basically you have multi-component mixture, and you want to predict whether this methane will be FCM or MCM or immiscible to the reservoir oil, we will see that we can predict through Tunney diagrams. Again, this third point will be better clear to you when we cover this presentation. So I skip this third point for now, and I will come back and will show you that how you use Tunney diagrams to predict the possible structure of the process, that whether it will be FCM or MCM. So now let's discuss Tunney diagrams. As I mentioned, that Tunney diagrams Tunney diagram is a diagram of at least three components: component A, component B, and component C. And basically, it shows the phase behavior, whether component will be in single phase, the mixture of the different components will be in single phase or in multi-phase condition. So first of all, we should be able to read the Tunney diagram. In this Tunney diagram, we have seen three components: component A, component B, component C. For example, component A is methane, component B is, for example, ethane, and component C is propane. So the lightest of the three component is plotted at the top of the triangle, and the heaviest among the three is plotted on the lower left of the triangle, and obviously the intermediate among the three is plotted on the bottom right. component A will be always be the lightest among these three. Component C will always be the heaviest among the three. Inside the Tunney diagram indicates basically the variation of each components. For example, component A is 100% at the top of the triangle. So the lines which are parallel to component A, basically indicating the variation of component B inside the Tunney diagram. So component A is 100% at the top of the triangle and 0% to the opposite side, which is the side connecting the component C and component B. So these lines which are at an angle of 0 degree, indicating the variation of component A. So this line basically showing the variation of component A, and component A is 90% here. Component on the second line, component A is 80%. On the third line, component A is 70%, and so on. Similarly, the lines which are at an angle of 45 degree, basically these lines are showing the variation of component B inside this Tunney diagram. So at point number one, component B is 100%, and on the first line of 45 degree, the component B is 90%, and on the second line, component B is 80%, and on the third line, component B is 70%, and so on. Component B is zero on the side basically connecting component A and component C. Similarly, component C is 100% at the lower left, and the line basically and the lines basically which are at an angle of 135 degree, these lines are showing the variation of component C inside the Tunney diagram. So the first line, which is which is just next to component C, is basically at and on this line component C is 90%. On the second line, component C is 80%. On the third line, component C is 70%, and so on. Component C is zero on the side connecting component A and component B. Any point basically lying on the side of the triangle, any point, for example, point number 2, point number 6, point number 4, any side basically lying on any side of the triangle basically indicate mixture of two component. For example, on point number 2, which is lying on the side connecting component A and C, at point number 2, component B is 0. So at point number 2, you have component C and component A. Obviously, we will see how to read exact composition. But one thing you remember, that on any side of the triangle, one component will be 0. On the side A and C, B will be 0. On the side A and B, component C will be 0. And on the side C and B, component A will be 0. So as I told you that each apex of triangle corresponds to 100% of a single component. Generally, the lightest component is plotted at the top, the heaviest component at the lower left, while the intermediates are plotted at lower right. Each side of the triangle represents two component mixture. For instance, left side of the triangle represents all possible mixtures of light and heavy components. Points within the triangle represents the three component mixture. Basically, this is important, and for us, that point lying inside the Tunney diagram indicates the mixture of three component. For example, at point number 3, component A, component B, component C, all the three components are present at point number 3. Similarly, at point number 7, which is also lying inside the Tunney diagram, all three components are present. So points within a triangle represents the mixture of three component, and generally composition, obviously we know that it is plotted in terms of mole fraction or mole percentage. One Tunney diagram is plotted for a constant pressure and temperature. For example, this is a diagram which is in a phase behavior condition of methane, propane, and butane. दिस स्टर्नाई डायग्राम बेसिकली हैज़ बीन जनरेटेड एट अ प्रेशर ऑफ 1500 PSI एंड एट अ टेम्परेचर ऑफ 160 डिग्री फ़ारेनहाइट। सो फॉर दिस टर्नरी डायग्राम प्रेशर एंड टेम्परेचर इज कॉन्स्टेंट एंड एंड ऑन द डिफ एंड बेसिकली एट डिफरेंट कंपोजिशन ऑफ डिफरेंट मिक्सचर्स यू कैन बेसिकली अंडरस्टैंड वेदर द मिक्सचर विल बी इन सिंगल फेज और लिक्विड फेज। सो सिंगल डायग्राम प्रेशर बोथ प्रेशर एंड टेम्परेचर आर कॉन्स्टेंट। ओनली थिंग विच इज चेंजिंग इन अ सिंगल टर्नरी डायग्राम इज द कंपोजिशन ऑफ इंडिविजुअल कंपोनेंट्स। सो यू कैन एज्यूम डिफरेंट मिक्सचर्स विद डिफरेंट कंपोजिशन एंड यू कैन बेसिकली चेक वेदर दैट मिक्सचर विल बी इन सिंगल फेज और इन टू फेज इन अ गिवन टर्नरी डायग्राम। सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ यू वॉन्ट टू रीड द कंपोजिशन ऑन ऑफ डिफरेंट पॉइंट्स on this Tannay diagram. So at point number one, which is lying exactly on the apex of the triangle, the composition of the mixture is that the mixture is composed of only single component, which is component B, and 100% of basically of mixture contains component B. For example, if you want to read the composition of the mixture at point number two, and since point number two is lying on one side of the triangle, and we know that on any side of the triangle, only two components are present. So at point number two, component B is zero, and only component A and C basically are present. And if you want to read the mole percentage of component A and component C at point number two, basically you first need to check on which lines point number two is lying. For example, at you see that point number two is lying on this horizontal line and on this 135 degree line. So once first you need to highlight the lines on which point number two is lying, and then basically you read the values of that line. For example, this horizontal line which is showing the variation of component A. So you read from the top from the diagram that first line 90% component A, second line 80% component A, third line 70% component A, and so on 60, 50, 40, 30. So at point number two, the horizontal line showing that this line component A is 30 mole percent. Similarly, if you want to read the value of component C on 135 degree line, 135 degree line basically is the third line from the 100% component C line. So 100%, 90%, 80% and 70%. So at point number two, basically the component C is 70 mole percent. So point number two, you have two components. One component is component C, which is 70%, and the other component is component A, which is 30%. So that's how you read the values at any point in the Tannay diagrams. For example, if you want to read the composition of the mixture at point number three, point number three is lying inside the Tannay diagram, and that indicates that we will have all three components at point number three. So again, you need to highlight all the lines on which point number three is lying. Basically, we have three lines. So horizontal line, the line which is at an angle of 0 degree, the line basically which is at an angle of 45 degree, and the line which is at an angle of 135 degree. So this is the point, this is horizontal line, this is the line which is at an angle of 45 degree, and this is the line which is at an angle of 45 degree and 135 degree. So again, you read the values. So the horizontal line is 90 80 70 60 50. So point number three, at point number three, component A is 50 mole percent. At point number three, component B, so component B you need to read it from the 45 degree line. So 100% कंपोनेंट बी 90%, 80%, 70, 60, 50, 40, 30. सो एट पॉइंट नंबर थ्री कंपोनेंट बी इज 30 मोल परसेंट. सो 50% कंपोनेंट ए, 30% कंपोनेंट बी, सो ऑटोमेटिकली कंपोनेंट सी विल बी 20%. यू कैन आल्सो रीड फ्रॉम दी 135 डिग्री एंगल लाइन. सो 100, 90, 80, 70, 60, 50, 40, 30, 20. सो एट पॉइंट नंबर थ्री यू हैव थ्री कॉम्पोनेंट्स, कॉम्पोनेंट ए, कॉम्पोनेंट बी एंड कॉम्पोनेंट सी. यू हाईलाइट द लाइन्स एंड देन रीड द लाइन्स फ्रॉम द 100%. सिमिलरली यू कैन रीड एनी वैल्यू इन साइड द टनाई डायग्राम्स. सो दिस आर डिस्क्रिप्शन रिटन ओवर हियर. यू कैन रीड इट. So again, come back to Tannai diagram. This is the Tannai diagram of three components, methane, propane and pentane, at the pressure of 1500 psi and a temperature of 160 degree Fahrenheit. As I have mentioned earlier that a single Tannai diagram is plotted at a constant pressure and temperature. This basically on through this diagram you can predict the mixture of these three components will be in single phase or basically liquid phase or in two phase condition. This is the phase envelope in the Tannai diagram. So any point, any mixture point that is lying inside this envelope will show that the mixture will be in two phase condition. Any mixture point that is lying outside the two phase envelope will show that the mixture will be in single phase condition. Let's assume you make a mixture in which pentane is, for example, 90%, propane is 5% and methane is 5%. So you have made a mixture where majority of the component is pentane. So 90% pentane, 5% methane and 5% propane. So that point will be lying somewhere here, which is again we know that these lines which are at an angle of 135 degree, these lines are showing the variation of pentane. And in this Tannai diagrams we have more than 10 lines, we have around 20 lines. So each line will be showing the showing the variation of a particular component by 5%. So 100 at lower left pentane will be 100%, on first line pentane will be 95%, on the second line pentane will be 90%. So pentane 90%, and we have assumed basically methane as 5%. So methane lines, the horizontal lines are showing the variation of methane. So on the first horizontal line from the bottom will indicate that methane is 5%. So this point basically is a point where the mixture has 90% pentane, 5% methane and around 5% propane. So this point basically is lying in the liquid condition. So the mixture will be in the liquid phase. So for example, if you assume a mixture with around, for example, 60% for example methane and 40% pentane. So we know that 60% methane and 40% pentane mixture will be lying on this side of the triangle. Since propane is zero, so the mixture of pentane and methane will be lying on this side of the triangle. 60% basically methane and 40% propane, this is the point, and this point basically is lying inside the envelope. So the mixture will be in the two phase condition. So basically that's how you read the Tannai diagrams. You assume a mixture that, for example, the mixture contains three components and this is the composition of each component in the mixture, and through Tannai diagram you predict that mixture will be in which phase, whether in single phase or in two phase condition. बेसिकली वी नो दैट वन इज कॉल्ड बबल पॉइंट लाइन एंड ड्यू पॉइंट लाइन, एंड द लाइन एंड द वेन वेयर दिस टू लाइन्स आर कनेक्टिंग दैट पॉइंट इज कॉल्ड द क्रिटिकल पॉइंट. दिस इज डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ द फिगर दैट द फिगर गिव्स द सेचुरेशन एनवलप फॉर द मिक्सचर्स ऑफ मीथेन प्रोपेन एंड पेंटेन एट द टेम्परेचर ऑफ 160 डिग्री फॉरेनहाइट एंड प्रेशर ऑफ 1500 PSI. अगेन मिक्सचर्स इन दिस स्टैंडर्ड डायग्राम्स यू कैन हैव हंड्रेड्स ऑफ मिक्सचर्स. वन मिक्सचर फॉर एग्जाम्पल हैव 90% पेंटेन, 5% प्रोपेन एंड 5% मीथेन. अदर मिक्सचर कैन हैव 90% प्रोपेन, 5% मीथेन एंड 5% पेंटेन एंड सो ऑन. यू कैन एज्यूम 50% पेंटेन, 25% मीथेन एंड 25% प्रोपेन. सो यू कैन बेसिकली एज्यूम डिफरेंट मिक्सचर्स विद डिफरेंट कंपोजिशन एंड यू कैन चेक देयर फेज कंडीशन. सो देर आर डिफरेंट मिक्सचर्स आर प्रेजेंट बट ऑल मिक्सचर्स आर एट अ टेम्परेचर ऑफ 160 डिग्री फॉरेनहाइट एंड प्रेशर ऑफ 1500 PSI. बबल पॉइंट एंड ड्यू पॉइंट लाइन्स ज्वाइंस बबल पॉइंट लाइन्स ज्वाइन एट क्रिटिकल पॉइंट. एज यू कैन सी दैट मिथेन इज द लाइटेस्ट अमंग द थ्री कॉम्पोनेंट्स. सो मिथेन इज प्लॉटेड एट द टॉप. सिंस पेंटेन इज द हैवीएस्ट इट इज प्लॉटेड ऑन द लोअर लेफ्ट. अगेन दिस डायग्राम इज फॉर सिंगल टेम्परेचर एंड सिंगल प्रेशर. एज द कंपोजिशन ऑफ मिक्सचर मिथेन प्रोपेन एंड पेंटेन चेंजेस द मिक्सचर मे बी इन सिंगल फेज और टू फेज कंडीशन. द पॉइंट्स लाइंग इन साइड द एनवलप इंडिकेट द टू फेज कंडीशन एट द टेम्परेचर ऑफ 160 डिग्री फॉरेनहाइट एंड प्रेशर ऑफ 1500 PSI. अगेन रिमेंबर दैट बेसिकली इन वेन एवर वी हैव सिंगल फेज कंडीशन वी विल बी से दैट इट्स अ मिसिबल कंडीशन एंड वेन एवर वी हैव टू फेज कंडीशन वी विल से इट्स अ immiscible condition. Remember the exercise we have done in lecture number 1 where all the points lying inside the envelope will show that the mixture will be in two phase condition, and whenever the mixture is in two phase condition we will say that the displacement will be immiscible because gas and liquid have not mixed together to form a single phase. This is another another illustration of Fernley diagrams. You see that there is a two-phase envelope. Any point lying inside the two-phase envelope showing the two-phase condition. Bubble point line and dew point line joins together at the critical point. The line basically that is tangent to the critical point is called a limiting tie line. This is a very important concept. Limiting tie line is the line basically that is tangent to the critical point. All the points which are outside this envelope but lower than the limiting tie line will show that the mixture will be in the gas phase. So in simple word, the region, this region which is basically above your two phase region and on the left side of your limiting tie line. So any mixture whose composition is lying in this region will show that the phase of that mixture will be gas phase. Similarly, any mixture which is below this two phase region and on the left side of the limiting tie line basically show that mixture will be in the liquid phase. Similarly, all the mixture which are right side of the limiting tie line basically shows that the mixture will be in the miscible zone. The fluid will be miscible. Again, the miscible fluid basically written over here is a supercritical fluid because the mixture in this zone is miscible to both liquid and the vapor phase. If you remember that we have discussed supercritical fluid in reservoir fluid properties course. In that course we have seen that a mixture basically whose pressure and temperature is higher than the critical pressure and temperature is called supercritical fluid, and basically the supercritical fluid is a fluid whose properties are in between those of liquid and gas. So in other words, सुपरक्रिटिकल फ्लूइड इज मिसिबल टू बोथ द गैस फेस एंड द लिक्विड फेस. वी विल ऑब्वियसली कवर दिस टॉपिक इन कमिंग स्लाइड्स टू. दिस स्लाइड इज शोइंग द डिफरेंट टनलिंग डायग्राम्स ऑफ C1, C3, C5 एट डिफरेंट प्रेशर्स एट अ कॉन्स्टेंट टेम्परेचर. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल एट वेरी लो प्रेशर C1, C3, C5 विल बी इन गैसियस फेज रिगार्डलेस ऑफ देयर इंडिविजुअल कंपोजिशन. एट सम हायर प्रेशर लाइक 200 PSI डिफरेंट मिक्सचर विल बी इन डिफरेंट फेज डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द कंपोजिशन ऑफ इंडिविजुअल कंपोनेंट्स एंड सो ऑन. एट वेरी हाई प्रेशर एट अराउंड 2350 PSI ऑल द मिक्सचर्स ऑफ C1, C3, C5 विल बी इन द लिक्विड फेज रिगार्डलेस ऑफ द कंपोजिशन ऑफ इंडिविजुअल कंपोनेंट्स. सो एट लोअर प्रेशर ऑल द मिक्सचर्स ऑफ C1, C3, C5 विल बी इन द गैसियस फेज एंड एट हायर प्रेशर अबव 2350 PSI ऑल द मिक्सचर ऑफ C1, C3, C5 विल बी इन द लिक्विड फेज. सो द इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग टू रिमेंबर फ्रॉम दिस स्लाइड इज दैट द टू फेज रीजन चेंजेस एंड बेसिकली डिक्रीजेस एज प्रेशर इज इंक्रीज्ड. एज यू कैन सी एट 2200 PSI द विथ ऑफ टू फेज रीजन इज डिफरेंट एंड एट अराउंड लाइक 1500 PSI द विथ इज डिफरेंट एंड एट अराउंड 2000 PSI the size of two phase region is different. So the two phase region basically is the region where you will have immiscible or condition, but outside this the but above this high pressure you will not have immiscible condition. So this is basically the conclusion from the last slide that with increase in pressure at constant temperature two phase region decreases, which is ideal for miscible displacement. Also with decreasing temperature at constant pressure two phase region decreases. So hence for miscible displacement low temperature and high pressure is and high low temperature and high pressure conditions are the favorable conditions. And since we all know that reservoir temperature is constant and generally we do not play with reservoir temperature, so the only thing that generally is basically controlled is the reservoir pressure. And basically we can increase the pressure up to the reservoir fracture pressure. So basically this is the diagram. Again you see that we have seen this Tunney diagram with three components C1, C3 and C5, but a reservoir may have other components too. So when basically we are plotting the mixture of reservoir oil and maybe the mixture of injected gas, basically we group them into these three terminologies. C1, which is the lightest at the top, the one group is C2 to C6, ethane to hexane, which is the intermediate group, and the third group, which is called the heavies, which is the heaviest fraction in your fluids, which is C7 plus. So the heaviest C7 plus is not a single component. It's a basically a group of all the heavier components. Similarly, this is the intermediate. This is not only the single intermediate component. It is basically a group of all intermediate components and the lightest. So we convert our the composition, we divide our the composition of reservoir oil and injected gas in three groups: the light, intermediate and heavies. Obviously the oil and the gas will be lying at any point in the tunneling diagram. For example, the G, this is the G is the point of your injected gas. Basically the injected gas G has most of the majority of the C1. So for example, this gas, the injected gas, is mostly comprises of C1 but also has some intermediate and C7 plus. So G point lying is lying inside the tunneling diagram. So as point number L, which is also lying inside the tunneling diagram, which shows that this liquid in reservoir basically is composed mostly of C7 plus, but it also has some C1N and some intermediate. So if you are mixing these two mixture together at some pressure and temperature, remember that this tunneling diagram has been plotted on a single pressure and temperature. So pressure and temperature is in the background of this tunneling diagram. So if you are mixing these two mixtures, which are labeled as G and L, and if the connecting line is passing through the two-phase region, so when the connecting line between two mixture is passing through the two-phase region, we will say that the result, the displacement of L by G, the displacement of reservoir oil, which is labeled as L, by the injected gas, which is labeled as G, the displacement of L by G will be immiscible. So this is the use of tunneling diagram, which I have told you that you will understand after studying tunneling diagram. So this is the first point, basically, that the third point basically of the first slide of this video, that if a straight line between the injected fluid and the crude passes through the two-phase region, the displacement will be immiscible. So if it doesn't passes, it will be miscible condition. So that is the basically the point that I have told you to explain later. You will understand more about this in the coming slides. Multiple contact miscibility, basically it is contrast to FCM process. In first contact miscibility, basically your injected fluid becomes miscible to your reservoir oil on its first contact. But in multiple contact miscibility, the injected gas basically we inject is immiscible in first contact with oil. But however, due to composition changes, which is mass transfer in the reservoir, eventually it gets miscible with your oil. So in multiple contact miscible, whatever gas you are injecting basically is immiscible to your oil at its first contact. So this is basically the mechanism behind it. During injection of gas into an oil reservoir, as long as the original fluids are not completely different in composition, there will be a gradual exchange of components between the two fluids, and their composition will become more alike. Eventually, part of the gas phase and the part of the oil phase will no longer be separated and will become miscible. Remember, we have discussed in the previous course, PE302 course, we have seen that the intermediate components, which are C3, C4, C5, C6, are volatile in nature. Volatile in nature means that they can either be in the part of your oil, or they can either be the part of the gas phase. Remember, when we were discussing the separator test, we have seen that we apply some pressure through separator test, and basically the purpose of separator is to enhance the liquid recovery. And how it enhances the liquid recovery? By basically maintaining your volatile components in the liquid phase. So these intermediate components are very sensitive and volatile in nature, and they can be part of the gas phase and they can be part of the oil phase. So in MCM process, basically you take advantage of this sensitive nature of intermediate component. So if your reservoir oil has a high intermediate component, you inject a gas which is lean in nature, which means that the gas does not have many intermediate components. So when that gas, which has less number of intermediate components, comes in contact with your reservoir oil, the intermediate components start diffusing from your oil into your gas phase. So gas basically is getting richer and obviously when that richer gas moves further in the reservoir, it comes in contact with other oil. It also takes intermediate component from other oil. So eventually that gas which is taking the intermediate components of reservoir oil is getting rich, and ultimately it becomes more like your oil reservoir, and it becomes miscible with your reservoir oil. So this is the one example of multiple contact miscibility, that the gas is taking the intermediate components from the oil with multiple contacts with oil, and eventually getting miscible with your oil. So basically, based on the transfer of intermediate components, whether the intermediate components are coming from oil into the gas, or whether the intermediates components are being transferred from gas into the oil, there are two types of multiple contact miscible process. The first one is called the vaporizing gas drive or high pressure lean gas. The process of vaporizing gas drive is done for oil rich in intermediate components. In this process, we inject a gas which is lean in nature and initially immiscible with oil on its first contact. As it comes in contact with oil, it takes intermediate components from the oil after multiple contacts, and ultimately it becomes so rich that it gets miscible with oil. So basically, we will study this process through this tunnel diagram. The R basically indicates the initial composition of reservoir fluid, and as mentioned over here that the oil in this process is basically rich in intermediate components, so it lies near to the bottom right. It has to lie near to this bottom right. Obviously, the question arises that if it doesn't lie near to the bottom right, then what? So this process of high pressure lean gas cannot be applied for the oil which are rich in heavy component. For this process to occur, the oil has to have intermediate components, and when the oil has intermediate components, the initial composition will be lying near to the bottom right. The gas is lean in nature. In this process, we inject gas which is composed of lightest component, mostly methane or with some ethane. So the initial composition of injected gas will lie near to the top of the triangle. So as you can see, the initial line that is connecting G and R is passing through the two-phase region. And we have seen in the previous slide that whenever the line that is joining that the composition of two fluids is passing through the two-phase diagram, the displacement will be immiscible. So initially, G and R will be immiscible. Obviously, with time, the gas will get intermediate components from the oil, so it will get richer. So dry gas getting richer, which means it is moving along the right direction from the top of the triangle to the lower right. So G1, G2, G3, G4, G5, these are the composition of the injected gas after multiple contacts with your oil. So after first contact with your oil, the gas composition becomes G1. So after second contact with oil, the gas composition becomes G2, G3, and so on. And as you can see, that gas is getting richer in intermediate component, which means that C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, the intermediate components from the oil is coming into the gas phase. The description is written in the next slide. So for example, consider we have an oil composition R in the reservoir, and we have to displace it with a lean gas of composition G. The composition of oil lies on the right-hand side of the limiting tie line because it is rich, while that of gas on the left-hand side of the tie line. So we have seen that limiting tie line is a line which is tangent to the critical point. So for high pressure lean gas process, the initial composition of reservoir oil lies to the on the right side of this limiting die line, and the initial composition of gas is lying on the left side of the limiting die line. As gas comes in contact with oil, the mass transfer of intermediate components occur from oil to gas, and gas is getting richer with contacts. So at the start of injection, displacement is immiscible, and phase exchange takes place, and after first contact, the composition of the gas has changed from G to G1 and composition of oil from R to R1. So you can also understand it from this figure. Originally, the oil was present and has some composition. You can label it O and or R. So when the injected gas G comes in contact with the oil, you have immiscible displacement, and with immiscible displacement, some of the oil is left in the swept zone. Remember, we have discussed in the first video that whenever you have immiscible fluids, the oil is trapped in the reservoir because of the high interfacial tension and high capillary forces. So same concept applied here, that initially you will have immiscible displacement, oil will be trapped in the swept zone. This G and oil O basically exchange components, or gas will become richer, and this gas which has taken the intermediate components from the oil is labeled as G1, because this G1 is different than the gas you have injected. Again, you are continuously injecting gas, so the previous gas which has taken components from the oil has moved further in the reservoir, and the new gas which you have injected in the reservoir has taken the place of the previous gas. So this G1, the gas which has taken the intermediate components of oil on its first contact, will move in the reservoir and will comes in contact with the fresh oil. Again, the exchange of masses takes place at the front. G1 will become G2, and again, as you keep on injecting gas from the bottom of the from the injection well, this G2 will move further in the reservoir and will come in contact with the fresh oil, which is called the virgin oil. So the composition of this changes continuously, and ultimately the composition of gas becomes so that it becomes like the oil, and it gets miscible with the oil. So the miscibility is achieved in this process after various contacts with the reservoir oil, which is written over here, that gas G1 comes in contact with oil of composition R, you can say O. Since fluids are not in equilibrium, phase exchange takes place and result in gas G2 and oil R2, oil R1 comes in contact with gas G. So basically, continuously your gas is taking intermediate components from your oil, rich gas moves further, and ultimately a time will come that this gas will become like your oil, and at that time you will have miscibility in reservoir, and basically afterward you will have a single phase condition reservoir. So this is basically a description of high pressure lean gas. The oil that has left behind is labeled as O1, O2, O3. Basically, it is also continuously losing its components to the gas that is coming from the injection well. In this process, some of the oil is remain in the reservoir, because initially you had the immiscible displacement. But once you have the miscibility achieved at the front, no oil will be left, and all of the oil will be produced, and hopefully you will have the piston like displacement. Again, for this process, you basically you need some high pressure, so that the two phase region should be small enough that the initial oil composition should lie on the right hand side of the limiting die line, and the gas injection should lie on the left side of the limiting die line. Basically, this is the process diagram. So gas is getting G G1, G2, G3 with context with the oil. For this process to occur, the initial composition of your reservoir oil should lie on the right side of your limiting dry line, which means initial composition should lie in the miscible zone. So this process will not occur if your initial oil composition is not lying in the miscible zone. And we have seen the effect of pressure on the two-phase region of the Tunney diagram. So this process will only occur when the pressure is sufficiently high that this two-phase region is small enough that this initial composition is lying on the right of this limiting tie line. So that is why this process is called high pressure lean gas, because you need some pressure to force the migration of intermediate components from oil into the gas. So basically, because of this, this process can be done in reef formations with high reservoir pressure. At shallow depth, formation may fracture as this process requires some high pressure. Again, I have mentioned that this process cannot be done for heavy oil reservoir. That's all from my side for this second lecture of miscible flooding.